slides in 15 minutes. Just hold on to your seatbelts. Okay, voter fraud, is it real? Oh, come on now.
Donald Trump says it is.
Okay, all right. Well, first of all, to prevent voter fraud, we've got two things to do. We've got to protect and we have to verify. We do that with ballots. We do that with voter registration. So if you just think in those quadrants, that's part of our job. First of all, protecting ballots. We've got, I think of it like a Russian doll, you know, one of those nesting eggs, and it all starts with people. We hire up to 500 extra hires for our large elections. Those people are not volunteers. They're paid, which means that they are treated to testing, criminal history background checks, and a third-party hiring process. Whenever I became auditor, no one could tell me how those 500 people showed up and where they came from. And it turned out they were just neighbors and neighbors and friends of neighbors and word of mouth and connected with political parties. So we've outsourced all of that now and professionalized it. And you can't get a job even on a part-time basis in elections without passing a battery of tests and a criminal history background check. And that's a good thing, I think. And our secret sauce is political party observers. Pierce County has absolutely the best political party observer program in Washington State. It's enshrined in law, and what it means is that I have a Democrat and a Republican that I do not pick. They are appointed by the party chairs. And anytime we have a voted ballot in-house at the election center, I have a D and an R there in the election center, observing how that ballot is handled, how it comes in, etc. That means that they're there for up to 30 days at a time for every single election, because anytime there's a live ballot in the House that is not locked up in a security zone, they have to be there when we're handling them. Did you know that? Did anybody know that? Okay. And they are the loyal opposition, kind of the way I think of them. They're not our friends. They're there to create a dynamic tension and to make sure that the policies that we publish, all this stuff that I'm telling you, we actually do it. And I really appreciate that. Another way we protect ballots is through inventory. We don't print our own ballots. We've got nearly 500,000 voters in Washington, in Pierce County. So we outsource that to Consolidated Printing in Seattle. But every single plate that's made to print a ballot, every overage, you know, because there's always some surplus, some spoiled printing slides, all of that is audited and accounted for. I often say I'm not an auditor, but this is where I really am an auditor. We have to account for every ballot that gets printed, every ballot that gets mailed, anytime a voter asks for a replacement ballot, spoiled ballots, if a ballot comes to us that's ripped and has to be remade to be machine readable, the counted ballots and the challenged or uncounted ballots, ends up in a spreadsheet that is viewable to the public at any time. And we've got archives that go back to 1984 with all of that inventory on it. Whenever we print ballots, and we always print a small surplus so that we can give somebody a replacement ballot at the front counter, all of that is audited. We zero out, and well, we like to zero out, but in fact, in an inventory, our reconciliation is 0.000097%. Did you know that? I've already talked about the political party observers and monitoring, and we do everything in pairs when we have a live election. So in other words, it's the first time a voted ballot comes in, we do everything in pairs. Our professional staff never do anything alone, whether it's picking up something from the post office or our ballot drop boxes or moving ballots into the tabulation and counting room. Everything is done in pairs. Every time we store ballots or sensitive equipment or have sensitive areas in our election center, we have tamper-resistant seals that are serialized that we keep track of. So a unique serial number, and we can tell if the seal has been tampered with or removed. And then on top of that, we have the two-by-two, the Noah's Ark of staff, always signing off two-by-two on oaths with those seals. So there's an oath inside the box or the room with that, that logs the serial number of the tamper-resistant seal. I could go on. Batch logs, again, when ballots come into our office, they're put in trays of 200, and a batch log follows them all the way to the end of the election. So of the 200 ballots, which ones were challenged because of a bad signature, which ones were ripped or torn, which ballots were for the wrong election, we get an astounding number of those where people send in a ballot that has nothing to do with what's happening. And we keep a batch log, that audit trail, to make sure that we can account for every single ballot and what happened to them in that batch of 200. Again, under the eyes of political party observers. We protect ballots physically. You can't get into the election center without a Lanell badge. Not only do you have a Lanell badge, but you have a six-digit code that has to match your identity, and all of that is logged and is part of the election archive. So you came into the building, what door, what time, and that they had security. We have limited access areas. I've got a reg badge, which means that I'm allowed anywhere in the election center. Not many people have these red badges, and we're again like a nesting egg. So we've got outer security. You have to have a Lanell badge and a six-digit code. But to get into the bowels of the election center, where the most sensitive work is done, you have to have one of these red badges. On top of that, we have surveillance cameras operating 24 hours a day. Those videos are again archived and on CD discs and put into the archive for the election. We have 19 motion activated security cameras throughout the building, so after hours. We don't tape during the graveyard shift because we're not working, but we do have 19 motion activated security cameras that will capture any motion inside the building, and that is off-site and monitored by a security department that's not part of elections. So I can't go and erase the tape and the evidence that I snuck in tonight with my red badge and created mayhem. And then we have servers and switch backup devices, again, in the most sensitive areas, and I can't even get into those locked cabinets, those IT cabinets. We've got an IT network that protects ballots. Everything in our system is air-gapped, which is exactly what it sounds like, which means it's not connected. I explain an air gap like, here's a computer, there's air. It's not connected to the internet, it's not connected to any other network, and the system will not allow any wireless technology to connect with it. We have a specialized router that if that happens, if we're probed by the Russians, or we had one dude that he's still around. He loves to sit out in our parking lot with devices and try to connect to our election system. And so he's just constantly probing it. If he were ever successful, like actually connecting somehow wirelessly to our system, it automatically shuts down. And it can't be restored without IP security there. And all of our network cabling in the tabulation room is visible on a racetrack up above, so you can see exactly where a wire starts, what it's connected to, and where it goes. And you can see that it's an air-gapped, closed loop. Any surprises there?
Yeah. What happens on the air-gapped networks if that goes down? I assume if it's not connected to the internet, there's no backup device.
Oh, hell no. So what if it breaks?
Yeah.
What if the server? So we've got redundant servers, obviously. And the other thing that we do is every day, actually multiple times a day, we make backups that our IT developer does, and those actually get mailed off-site to a data vault that I can't tell you about. And so it resides there. Back. So we can restore an election up to a certain point, but because Washington State has a paper ballot trail, which is awesome, we can always rerun the ballots because they're always in our possessions, they're secure, they're accountable, we know exactly where they are, which ones have been counted, which ones need to be restored, and we can always rerun the election.
So Julie, do you scan the ballots?
We do. And I'll, if I have time at the end, I'll tell you that there's a big, very positive switch that makes our elections even more secure, and we're moving from an optical scan system to a digital scan system, which is fabulous. All of the machines that are used, whether it's a scanner or a server or even a printer or that Cisco security switch that I talked about, everything has to be independently tested by a national lab before I can put it in the building and use it, the actual equipment. The same with software. Also, the system is tested and certified by the Secretary of State's office, and it's tested and certified by the National Election Assistance Commission if that commission doesn't get shut down, which some people are trying to do right now. We verify ballots. So it's not good enough just to protect them and have all these layers of security. We always want to be testing the what if. How do you know? How do you know? How do you know? So we verify. We have that paper trail that I talked about. We have paper ballots. And if you come into a voting center because you lost your ballot and you want to vote, again, you're issued a paper ballot. So we can always go back and inspect them, recount them if necessary. And we do a logic and accuracy test pre-testing. So this secure system that's been nationally and statewide certified that I talked about is also tested before every election in the presence of political party observers, a representative from the Secretary of State, and it's an open public meeting. And what we do is we produce ballots. The Secretary of State's office says, here's a mock election. Here are your expected results. Here are the ballots. Run them through the machines. We do, and we make sure that the tally of the machines matches a hand count of those ballots, and we do that with the political parties there. We also check version control and hashtags on each of the machines to verify that they haven't been tampered with, that there's been no executable files touched on any of those machines, and that the version hasn't changed. We also do midstream random election audits, which means, you know, for those of you that are always anxious about why does it take so long to get results, in addition to checking signatures of every single ballot, we also stop the election in midstream to do a random audit. The two political parties get to choose the date and the time of that. They have to work together and come to a consensus. So they choose a date and time, and they say, we want a random audit of the legislative district 27. We want to test that machine, and that machine, and we will pull the ballots that we have not counted yet that pertain to legislative district 27. We will run them in like 200 of them. We'll run them in their selected machines, and again, we'll check it against a hand count of those ballots, and they do that with us to make sure that the ballots are scanning correctly and being counted correctly. Again, that is another open public meeting if you want to have some fun. We also need to protect voters. So Washington State, the voter registration system, so you're understanding that there's two ways to create fraud. One is tampering with the ballots and the way they're counted, and the other is tampering with who's registered to vote and their documentation. Washington State does not use a top-down model. We have a distributed model so that the Secretary of State's office and the 39 counties work together to manage voter registration. That means that we have redundancy and replication. So if the voter registration system goes down, we've got our own voter registration system, and we sync up throughout the day, like about every hour we sync up. Our voter registration system in Pierce County is not connected to the internet. The Secretary of State's office is. The good thing about this kind of distributed network, in addition to the replication, is that and there's very, very little chance of this, but let's say some malware got into the Secretary of State's database. It can't create a wildfire amongst the 39 counties. In addition to that, the 39 counties have different different systems. So Pierce County's registration system is on a virtual machine in a secure data center. There's no internet connection. It's protected by a firewall. For those of you that remembered my promotion of that Civic app, right? Going, okay, fancy pants. If it's not connected to the internet, then how can I call it up on my phone and figure out that my ballot just arrived? That's because we put that voter registration data on a replication server that's different than our voter registration. So you can tap into that without actually getting into the voter registration. So you can create all the mayhem you want to on the virtual server if you're super smart, but you're not going to be getting into the voter registration system. So we protect the voter registration system, but some of you may remember during the November election and other times where campaigns and political parties sent postcards saying, you haven't, your neighbor hasn't voted, you know, or you've only voted in 2 out of 4 elections. Do you guys remember that?
Yes.
Okay. So how did they get that data if we keep everything secure? Because your voter registration is a public record, and for $15, anybody can get the entire state's voter registration database, including your address, your gender, your date of birth, how many elections you've participated in, and where you live. So it's secure, but it is not private. Now, your vote, how you voted is private, right? Who you voted for is private. And if anybody tells you in those postcards or whatever that they know that you're a Republican or a Democrat, they're making inferences or they're making that up. They're not getting that us. We want to verify voters. So the system is secure. Voter registration requirements, you only need the name, the address, birth date, gender, and Washington State driver's license or ID number or a social security number. So either the driver's license or social security. That's all we're allowed to ask for in a voter registration process, and frankly, that's all we need. After we get a voter registration in Washington State, we have online voter registration. That's why the Secretary of State's voter registration is connected to the internet, so you can go sign up or you can go update your address. So once we get voter registration, and the vast majority is online or through Motor Voter, where you're signing up either for public benefits or a driver's license or something, and this is federal law, and then that you are asked whether you want to register to vote, and then that gets pushed into the voter registration system. Less and less are we seeing voter registration drives using paper and pen that we hand enter. But once we get that data, whether it's on paper or whether it's Motor Voter or whether it's another county moving their voter to Pierce County, we check all of that data against LexisNexis, United States Postal Service addressing, the Department of Corrections. People say don't felons vote on a quarterly basis. The state's voter registration system is checked against a Department of Correction basic attendance role. And if people are in the custody of the Department of Corrections serving a felony sentence, they're flagged in that system and they're notified that they're going to be taken off of the voter registration rolls. The same is true with death records through the health department on a quarterly basis. In Pierce County, we don't like to wait for that because there's nothing more heartbreaking than having a widow or a widower receive the ballot of somebody that just died. So we read the obituaries every single morning and proactively enter people as deceased when we see their obituary if they're a registered voter. Citizenship. I'm sure you guys have a question about this, right? There is no database, even though we've got all those records to check against, there is no such thing as a list of citizens in the United States. No such thing. There is also not a list of non-citizens in the United States. So I cannot check against that. In most states, the driver's license requires a component of proving, not just proof of residence, but sometimes proof of citizenship. In Washington State, I mean, there's a big kerfuffle if you've been following the news about this. That is not true. The legislature is moving a bill through right now that doesn't really fix the problem. It creates a two-tier licensing system, a driver's license with proof of citizenship and a driver's license that doesn't prove citizenship. And the proof of citizenship is going to cost more. Wow, I could really get into the weeds of this, but so some of my skeptical friends really latch on to this dilemma that we have about, well, if all you need is a driver's license to register to vote, and the driver's license doesn't require proof of citizenship, aren't you just registering a bunch of people who aren't citizens and not eligible to vote? No, I don't think that we are. Even if you apply for a driver's license and you don't have proof of citizenship, you do have to prove your residency in Washington State. And DOL has 30,000 residency verifications every year. So if you present yourself and you don't have documentation at that high level, they make you make an appointment with an administrator and come back a different day. If you were somebody in the country illegally and you were not eligible to vote, I think that that would be pretty scary and you wouldn't show up for your appointment. And in fact, most people do show up for their appointment and they are able to verify their residency, not their citizenship, but their residency. Only 0.3% of DOL's contacts indicate or have flags for fraud. So when you scope that out, that is a very, very small amount. In addition, voters have to sign an oath or affidavit. If they are going to register to vote or if they're going to cast a ballot, it's a Class C felony for them to do that if they're not eligible, if they're not 18, and if they're not residents. Holy cow, you guys, this is way too big of a presentation. We also verify voters through our voter registration management system. So I talked about how we get voter registration, how we check it against various databases, but we also are checking the activity of a voter. So everybody here that's a registered voter has a unique voter ID number, similar to a serial number, a social security number, but not. Every single ballot that's issued to you is logged for as long as you've been doing this digitally. Your signature is verified. Every single ballot that comes to us, we match that against your voter registration file. And if we receive your ballot and your signature does match, we give you credit in the voter registration system for that election, which means if later you or somebody in your household comes to us and they say, he lost his ballot, can we get a replacement ballot? No, you can't, because we show that we've already given you credit and that ballot's already been processed. Interestingly, I want you to know that I am prohibited by law from doing anything other than verifying what's on the voter registration form, whether it's digital or on paper. So I am prohibited from being a private investigator, and I have to take at face value what the voter puts on their voter registration form. If they're going to lie about what address that they're living at, if they're going to lie about being over the age of 18, I can check the age and I can check the address, but I can't go beyond what's called the four corners of the form. I can't say, that's kind of a Spanish surname.